Your solar panels turn sunlight into energy, but without the solar inverter, that energy is useless. In this video, we explain how solar inverters work, the different types available, and how to choose the best one for your system so you get the most out of your solar investment. All right, Larry, so what is a solar inverter and what role does it play in the overall system?
So as we said, the solar inverter takes the electricity that the panel creates and actually makes it useful.
Yeah.
And the way that it does that, Warren, is it converts DC electricity coming off the roof, coming off your solar panels, into AC electricity that you can use in your home or your business. Now, another thing that it does is it maximizes the output of your solar panels through maximum power point tracking. And basically what that means is it looks at where your voltage and current is coming off of each panel, and it moves back and forth and finds the perfect spot, the perfect combination of voltage and current to make the most power from that panel or from that string of panels. So without it, your panels are kind of lost as to what they're actually producing. And then the third thing that it does is it monitors system output and communicates to an online portal. So it monitors the output. It also monitors if there's issues. So depending on what equipment you have, it might even monitor your solar panels if they have issues. And it certainly monitors any issues with your inverter. Maybe one of them is down, maybe the grid's down. It monitors all those things and then reports to an online portal. So we can see it, the customer can see what's going on as well.
So basically we have three types of inverters. We have string inverters, micro inverters, and then string inverters with optimizers. Let's run through each of these and talk about them. First, let's start off with string inverters. How do they work and when should they be used?
So string inverters historically have been the most common inverter. Typically, they're connected to strings of panels. Strings are typically 6 to 12 panels. Now, some larger commercial projects can have 20 or maybe even 30 panels in a string.
Yeah.
And they maximum power point track the entire string together.
Okay.
So they keep that whole string in sync and try to pull out as much as they can out of that string. The primary use case is going to be ground mounts.
Okay.
They can be used on rooftops in certain situations when special conditions are met, and I'll just talk about that briefly in a bit. But they're going to be primarily ground mounts. That's the use case. That's where they make the most sense. Now, you can use them on the rooftop, like I mentioned, with rapid shutdown devices.
Right.
So with the advent of the rapid shutdown requirements, it also pushed string inverters to either go to ground mounts or to add these additional devices. Similar to string inverters, these inverters with rapid shutdown devices still maximum power point track that whole string together. But the rapid shutdown devices will shut that panel down individually if the inverter ever shuts down. So that's what the meaning of the rapid shutdown device is. So if you include that, you can now install that string inverter just like you did in the ground and install it on the roof as well.
And the rapid shutdown add-on is not to be confused with optimizers, which we're going to get to in just a minute. That's separate. The string inverters with the rapid shutdown option only.
That's correct. So you design it just like it's a string inverter without any optimizers, but then you add these devices for rapid shutdown only.
All right, so let's talk about microinverters. How do they work and when should we use them?
So microinverters is one inverter per panel.
Right.
So you install the inverter under the panel, you install the panel on top, you connect the two together, and there you have your system. Now these can maximum power point track each panel individually and monitor each panel individually, which is a benefit there. These are used often in roof mounts. Typically, a microinverter will be used in smaller roof mounts because they convert to AC right away up on the roof, and they're moving the power at a lower voltage AC rather than higher voltage DC, so they're not as efficient. So they're going to be used on smaller roof mounts close to the interconnection point. They're often used for shaded areas or if there's, you know, a higher level of monitoring required or more complex systems. That's a good fit for microinverters.
And then finally, string inverters with power optimizers. How do they work? When do we use them?
So this is a different technology than microinverters, but similar functionality.
Right.
So basically, they have up on the roof, they have a device that's a DC to DC converter. And then on the ground, they have the DC to AC conversion down there. So essentially, up on the roof is where the maximum power point tracking works individually again with each panel. And they individually monitor each panel just like a microinverter, which means that they can be used on roof mounts, they can be used in shaded areas, complex systems, just like a microinverter can. And they also have the higher level of monitoring like the microinverter does. But instead of doing all the functionality up on the roof, they convert from DC to AC at the ground level, close to your connection point, which means it's going to be a little bit more efficient, a little bit better performance than a microinverter typically.
Power optimizers have the ability for a rapid shutdown as well.
Yep, they do rapid shutdown. They do optimization, the whole nine yards. And I'll say this too, like there's, SolarEdge is the main brand, and there you have to use their inverter and their power optimizer together. But there's other brands that have, maybe one brand is the inverter, and another brand is the optimizer, and you can do some mixing and matching of brands. Obviously, you always want to double check with both manufacturers before you do that.
So let's compare inverter efficiency and performance for each of these three groups of inverters.
Yeah, so in general, microinverters and string inverters with optimizers, again, two different technologies, but same or similar functionality. In general, those two options will produce more because they eliminate the module-to-module mismatch,
right,
or production variations, and they mitigate losses from shade. So typically, they're going to produce more. In situations where there is no shade, the production difference between string inverters and microinverters or string inverters with optimizers is going to be very similar.
What about the maintenance and the lifespan between these three?
So maintenance and lifespan is going to vary a bit. Microinverters are typically going to come with a 25-year warranty, microinverters and power optimizers. Most residential inverter warranties can be extended up to 25 years. Most commercial inverter warranties can be extended up to 20 years. The lifespan should be similar, but when you have optimizers and microinverters, you introduce a lot more parts. So a string inverter, one box in the ground.
Right.
Microinverter is one per panel. Optimizer is one per panel plus a box in the ground. They should have similar lifespans. It's just you're going to have a lot more equipment with the optimizer and microinverter solution, which might mean more maintenance with those solutions.
How about monitoring for each of these?
Most manufacturers are going to have great monitoring ports. I mean, that's kind of like the standard,
right,
is to have something that's pretty good. However, microinverters and optimizers will provide you with module level monitoring, while string inverters will typically provide you with inverter level or maybe string level monitoring. So an optimizer or microinverter system can provide your company that does your maintenance work with more information, can provide you with more information, but every solution is going to provide you monitoring of production and system alerts.
And are there differences, Larry, between grid-tied and off-grid inverters?
Yeah, so there are some differences. Grid-tied inverters are typically going to be cheaper and more efficient. Off-grid inverters are going to typically allow for much higher backup loads, so they're going to be a lot more expensive. Generally speaking, you're not going to have a microinverter that's an off-grid inverter, because typically an off-grid inverter is going to be a hybrid inverter, which is going to do both batteries and solar.
Yeah.
Generally speaking, off-grid inverters can be a lot more expensive, and it's going to do both solar and batteries, and it's probably going to be a string inverter in most cases.
So Larry, let's talk about grid-tied systems with battery storage.
Yep. So a little bit different from off-grid.
Yeah.
These are connected to the grid, but still provide battery backup. Fortunately, many inverter manufacturers also make batteries as well.
Right.
So it makes it really easy to integrate systems together. Microinverters typically offer an AC coupled solution. Again, AC coupled is a separate inverter for your solar array, separate inverter for your battery system. String and power optimizer systems typically offer a DC coupled solution, which is a hybrid inverter that does both functions, solar and battery.
Let's talk about inverter sizing, undersizing versus oversizing and potentially clipping.
Yeah, so for all three of these inverter types, you always have that question.
Yeah.
With string inverters, you're looking at all the strings, all the panels that are going to that one inverter. With microinverters, you're looking at individual panels going to each individual microinverter, but the question is still the same. Should you undersize? Should you oversize? What's the balance between underutilizing the solar panels and underutilizing the inverters? That's something that must be considered during system design. And there's some considerations, you know, with that equation. Those considerations include, you know, what's your desired power output? How much do you want to actually produce? What's your array derate factors? What are going to be your losses for shade, orientation, and tilt? You know, if you're on a north-facing roof, now suddenly you can have a higher DC to AC ratio and not expect as much clipping. If you're in the southeast on a southern-facing roof, you're going to have a lot more clipping in that situation. What's the cost of solar panels and what's the cost of the inverters? What's the equipment size upgrades that you might need? What's your current utility equipment? Are you going to need upgrades to that equipment? What's the size of your AC equipment and wire? These are all things to take into consideration. There might be cases, Warren, where there's a limit. You know, you have a 15 kVA transformer, and so we're going to give you 15 kW of inverters and max them out because you want as much production as you can without upgrading your transformer. Those are all considerations that are all the same, whether you're looking at microinverters, string inverters, or string and power optimizers.
And then are there safety features that are different between each of these?
All inverters safely shut down when the grid is down.
Yeah.
That's the same no matter what you're using. Now, microinverters and optimizers and rapid shutdown devices also turn off at the panel level whenever the inverter shuts down. So that's a safety feature as well. Microinverters will run at a lower voltage, 240 volt AC for a single phase system, much lower voltage than either optimizers or string inverters. Those are typically going to be 450 volts to 600 volts DC, somewhere in that range. So your string inverters are going to be at a higher voltage. Your microinverters are going to be at a lower voltage. The safety difference between those two is very, very small. These systems are designed and built to be very safe. So that's a very insignificant safety difference.
Okay. And then when it comes to installing the inverters, does the location matter, whether they have exposure to the sun or anything like that?
Yeah. So you want to install them in the shade if you can. You want to avoid direct sunlight if possible. That direct sunlight or heat may cause the inverter to derate, to not be as efficient. Or it may also slightly reduce the lifespan. One other thing I'll mention too is your optimizers and your microinverters are up in the heat and cold and the elements all the time.
Right.
If you can install your inverter in your garage where the temperature doesn't swing quite as wildly and where it doesn't get sunlight or rain or snow, that's helpful. It's not required, but it certainly is helpful in increasing that lifespan.
If you want to keep learning about solar, subscribe to our channel for honest, expert insights on all things solar energy. For additional in-depth guides, tools, and ROI calculators, check out our Solar Learning Center, linked in the description below. At Paradise Energy, we're a family-owned, full-service solar company helping businesses, farmers, and homeowners across the Mid-Atlantic save with every sunrise. If you're ready to talk solar, connect with one of our local experts using the link in the description below. Before you go, please don't forget to like this video and drop a comment to let us know what you learned. Thanks for watching.